thanks for all the new guys coming here to our talk, Saving Humanity Through the Discovery of Wormholes by Lina and me. Thanks for all the new guys coming here to our talk, Saving Humanity Through the Discovery of Wormholes by Lina and me. So cloned Mileva from the future came to us and said, climate change is unstoppable. New planets need to be colonized. Intergalactic travel through wormholes will be possible, and the detection of black holes is necessary. So we need to reach 85% rock out, which is as high as it gets. And we want, it's important because we don't want to invest in a travel to a black hole and then there is none. On the right-hand side, you see a picture of the theory, the general relativity theory by Einstein. And basically every mass deforms the space-time. So there will be a bend of this grid you see here. And if you have two masses and they rotate fastly around each other, then they will form waves in space-time, which are called gravitational waves. And these are the ones we want to detect. On the right-hand side, we see a Virgo detector in Pisa, Italy. It has these long arms, and gravitational waves coming from space will shorten or lengthen these arms with respect to each other. And there's a laser shooting through these arms and basically measuring the distance of these arms. And these differences in length can be measured now. On the right-hand side, we see now an example of the data we face. And what we see here is actually not the gravitational waves. It's just the noise of the detectors. And the gravitational waves is buried on a very much lower scale inside these curves. So we can't really see them with the naked eye. And if we put this raw data just in a time series classification and calculate the accuracy, then we only get a random accuracy of 0.5. Another challenge we face is that we have more than 50 gigabytes of data, and this only getting random accuracy shows us that we need to do some feature engineering in order to improve our results. Now we will talk about some approaches we used.
I'm so sorry. I don't know what's up.
So the first approach is the constant Q transformation. It's basically a transformation into frequency realm like Fourier transform. And it gives us this nice picture we see on the right. It's widely used in music processing, and it's very closely related to the Morley wavelets. And gravitational waves are basically a superposition of these Morley wavelets. So this approach seems to be very promising.
Our second approach was the male frequency subcircle coefficients method. And if you hear that for the first time, it's probably quite of a mouthful. So let me introduce it to you. The male frequency means just that our frequency is scaled now by a special method, the male method. And a substral is simply a spectrum of a spectrum. But since this doesn't sound that great, developers decided to put the letters backwards. So instead of spec, you get seps. And the coefficients coming from the Fourier transformation we do, and we do one actually twice in this method. And it takes, or it gives us a real and a complex part. And they are multiplied by a coefficient. And these are the ones you can see in this image on the right-hand side. And they are plotted over space and time because they're taking different values in it. And normally this method is used for speech recognition, or you know, the app where you can hum a song and then tells you which song it is. That's the MFC method behind it. And what it makes it so special is that it separates the excitational signal from the impulse response, or in other words, the spectral envelope from the spectral detail. And this is what you can see on the image on the bottom. There is this huge red line, and this is the envelope, while the rest is the detail. And this is why they differ so much in their values. And another advantage of this method is that it reduces the number of dimensions. Our third approach were filters according to a paper we found from Green and Moffat. And on the right-hand side, you can see an example of a strain. And it is actually possible to extract the waveforms from it by using a complex series of filters. So the waves are actually visual right now. And if we could do that with our strains, we could use that for a time series classifier, and then we would have a really good model. So let's have a look how it did on our strains. And unfortunately, the filter strain is not really clear. Why is that? That's because the strengths of the gravitational waves differ from each other. That means, or that is because every black hole has a different mass. So that's why you have different strengths in the waves. And to make them visible, we would need individual filter settings for each strain. This is simply not possible for us because we would need to go through more than 500,000 strains. But we used that anyway and put it into a time classifier. And we got a result out which were better than random, so the model could find something in it, but not as much as we had with the frequency domain approaches. So, but we could use that anyway and pre-filter our other approaches with it. So as you can see now, we did it on the Q transformation. And since we cut out the low and the higher frequencies, the image is cleared now, and it shows us more detail. And that's where we're coming to our modeling right now.
So what we actually did now is took these images, which were done by either the MFCC or the Q transform, and we did image recognition with them. And we used a pre-trained convolutional neural network, which is called efficient net. It's a network which was trained on the ImageNet dataset. You have a few examples on the right. And this ImageNet dataset consists of 14 million images.
Now, since we are done with the modeling, we can carry on with our results. Because we had such a huge data set, our first calculation we did only with 10% of the data and calculated only one epoch. And that should already give us a hint which approach is good and we could continue and which not is good. And as you can see on the right hand side, the Q transform is the blue and the orange line, and those approaches performed better than the MFCC. It had a large area under the rock curve, and also with the pre-filtered data, we could reach an improvement. The MFCC, on the other hand, has a lower computational time, and the results were more balanced. And also what I want to point out here is that the pre-filtered data did not end up with the better results, and that is because, as I said before, we separate the envelope, the spectral envelope, from the detail, and by cutting out the high frequencies, we already took the envelope away. So, and this picture we see right here is also mirrored in our confusional matrices. On the left hand side, you can see the Q transformation, and it had the higher accuracy, And also, which is really good for our stakeholder, we reached a really high precision. So if this model found a black hole, you can be 94% sure that it really is a black hole. On the other hand, our MFCC result had a more balanced data results, and it found more black holes. But you can't be as sure as with the Q transformation that it really is one. So since the Q transformation showed us a better result, we continued with that approach and trained it with 100% of the data, and we already reached really good results with the 5 epochs. And in order to do so, we had to transfer on the our data on the Google Cloud, and we modified our code to run on TPUs in order to parallelize our code and getting a better computational time. And by doing so, we were able to reach our target value. But unfortunately, the pre-filtered data we used did not show any improvement. And you can see that also in the confusion matrices, there's not really a difference, but you can see that the non-filtered show a tiny bit of a better result. So what does it give us, or what can we do still about it? Well, we still could do an ensemble method of the two models, like the MFCC and the Q-transform, since the results were shifted. So this could give us a little bit more of accuracy. And another thing we could do, and we think this is a determining factor, is the filter options. Since we had good results with the 10% of the data, but not so good with 100%, we think by using maybe some other filters or with changing the setting of the filters, we could reach better results. And another thing would be, but this is a really more of a bigger scientific project, is to develop an algorithm to specify the filter setting for each strain. But in conclusion, we can say that transforming time series in the frequency domain gives really good results. And we were able to reach the target value and even surpass the expectations. So from our point of view, there's nothing standing in the way now of saving humanity and travel to wormholes. And we wish our stakeholder good luck with that mission, and we wish safe travels.